It's Professor Dave. Let's learn about square roots.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We've learned how to solve simple algebraic equations. We just look at what is happening to the variable we want to solve for, and we do the inverse of that operation to both sides. If we have x plus 2, we subtract 2. If we have 3x, we divide by 3. What if we have x squared equals 9? What is the inverse of squaring something? That would be taking the square root. When we take the square root of x squared, we get x, because squaring x is what would give us x squared. On the other side, the square root of 9 is equal to 3, because 3 squared, or 3 times 3, gives us 9. So taking the square root of something is like asking what number times itself will give us the number inside the square root. We must point out something very important here. Negative 3 is also a valid answer for the square root of 9, because negative 3 times negative 3 also equals 9. Remember that a negative number times a negative number is positive, so both of these values work for the square root of 9. That means that the square root of 9 is equal to positive 3 or negative 3, which we sometimes label this way, with both the plus and minus sign next to the 3, and we refer to this as plus or minus 3. Any square root will do this, so there are always two answers when we take a square root. Since negative 3 squared equals 9, we should also note that the square root of negative 9 is not negative 3. In fact, there is no real solution to this term, so we can't take the square root of negative numbers the way we take the square root of positive numbers. If we were to try to do so, we would get an imaginary answer, which is something we will investigate later in the series. For now, let's just say that only positive numbers can have their square root taken. It's very easy to get the square root of perfect squares. The square root of 4 is plus or minus 2. Continuing down the list, 9, 16, 25, 36 all give very tidy answers when we take the square root. We should make some effort to memorize the first 10 or even 20 perfect squares, because they will come in handy later. But the numbers in between these perfect squares also give a square root. It just won't be an integer. Some of these roots give a decimal value that goes on forever, meaning they are irrational. We will talk more about this concept later, but for now, let's acknowledge that this is an interesting result, because it means that there are real numbers that can't be expressed as fractions, no matter how big we make the denominator. We should also note that radical expressions, as we often call them, can sometimes be simplified. Take something like root 8. 8 is not a perfect square, so we can't get a neat and tidy answer when we take its square root. But we can change 8 into 4 times 2. The reason we would want to do this is that root 4 times 2 is the same as root 4 times root 2. And root 4 does work out nice and tidy, since it's equal to plus or minus 2. So root 8 can be simplified to become plus or minus 2 root 2. We could say the same for root 27. 27 is 9 times 3, and root 9 is plus or minus 3, so we get plus or minus 3 root 3. Just remember to look for any factors that are perfect squares in order to get these expressions to their simplest form. Are there other roots we can take besides the square root? Certainly, we can take the cube root. This is the opposite of cubing something, or raising it to the third power. If x cubed is 27, what is x? We will now have to take the cube root of both sides. This is like saying what number raised to the third power will give the number inside this root. In this case, the answer is 3, because 3 times 3 times 3 equals 27. Also notice that in this case, this is the only answer. Negative 3 doesn't work, because negative 3 times negative 3 times negative 3 equals negative 27. So negative 3 is the cube root of negative 27. In this way, cube roots differ from square roots, first because you can take the cube root of a negative number, and second because any number will only have one unique cube root, rather than two. If we take the fourth root of something, we see that the rules are similar to square roots, in that we can't take the fourth root of a negative number, because multiplying a negative value four times gives us a positive value. Taking the fifth root sees us going back to rules like for the cube root. We alternate back and forth depending on whether the root is odd or even. Odd roots have one real solution, and even roots have two real solutions. For now, we just have to accept this, but later we will get a more satisfying explanation. We now come to one of the most important things to understand about roots. We have to realize that they represent fractional exponents. Taking the square root is the same thing as raising something to the 1/2 power. This is because if the square root of something times itself should equal the original value, like how root x times root x equals x, then it must be the case that we can express this as x to the 1/2 times x to the 1/2 equals x to the 1, since 1/2 plus 1/2 equals 1, according to the rules of exponents. This is a notational choice, and it works for any exponent. Taking the cube root is the same as raising something to the 1/3 power. We can also combine two different operations into one fraction. Raising something to the 2/3 power means squaring it and taking the cube root. So 8 to the 2/3 power equals 4, which we can verify by either squaring first and then taking the cube root, or taking the cube root and then squaring. In this way, x to the a over b power simply means to multiply x by itself a times, and then take the b root. When we combine this with what we know about operations with terms raised to exponents, we can do seemingly tricky things. Take this expression here, the square root of x times the cube root of x divided by the fourth root of x. First, let's change this to x to the 1/2 times x to the 1/3 divided by x to the 1/4. Since x to the a times x to the b equals x to the a plus b, we simply add these exponents together on the top. To do so, we need a common denominator for these fractions, so we change them to 3/6 and 2/6, and add them together to get 5/6. Then, if dividing by the x to the 1/4, we subtract, which means we need the lowest common denominator, which will be 12. So 10/12 minus 3/12 equals 7/12. And there you have the simplified version of the original expression, x to the 7/12 power. Let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.